Okay, I think we should get started. apologies for this slight delay. Shall we begin by standing up for the Polish national anthem and the Ode to Joy, please? Please be seated. Okay. I'm sorry, could you please come over here, and from down here you'll be able to see which of the seats are still unoccupied. Yes, please. Okay. Normally, I would begin by welcoming our numerous guests. The list would be rather long. We would be joined by representatives of U.S. Embassy, embassies of Latin American countries. We would have a flesh and blood choir to sing for us. But this is not a normal time. There has been nothing routine in what we have been doing since March 2020. Nothing is more unsanitary, as you know, than collective singing, so we can't have a real choir. We simply wanted to hold a real-time welcome event for our students, for those of us who managed to join us in person, and for a lot more of our students, BA and MA freshers, who are watching us today on their laptops, desktops, or smartphones. We just wanted to make our new students feel we are flesh and blood teachers and scholars who will be doing our best to make our American Studies program worth their while. We have been joined today by very few faculty, all of whom are here for a reason. These are faculty members who you should know, you should know about, and they're here because they will speak. So let me begin by welcoming our guests, Professor Tomasz Basiuk. I'd like to welcome Professor Tomasz Basiuk, the director of the Institute of the Americas in Europe. And I will explain what the Institute of the Americas in Europe is later on. Professor Basiuk teaches American fiction, teaches about American fiction, critical theory, cultural studies. I want to welcome our faculty is today sort of decimated, but two important faculty members are here because they will be playing important roles, because they are coordinating your programs. So I want to welcome Dr. Małgorzata Gajda-Maszewska. She's this media expert, Professor Kuzma Markowska, social and cultural historian of the US. And I'm sure we're being watched by many other ASC faculty members. Now I want to welcome Professor Pawel Frelik. His teaching on and researching science fiction, audiovisual media, and popular culture. Those are faculty members I've invited to this meeting because I was very worried that I would have not enough space to accommodate only a handful, at least a handful, of BA and MA freshers. So I was rather uninviting to other faculty members. I'm sure we're being watched by the ASC faculty. If you go to our website, you will see that this event is being live streamed on our website and also on our ASC Facebook profile. Also, I want to welcome the head of the student union, Aleksandra Mackiewicz. And also Filip Boratin is with us. He's our USO specialist, a very important person, a very important staff member and a doctoral student who you will be dealing with him and you will be working with him because he coordinates our USO's program. I know that he's planning a training session for you how to navigate our website and the USO's. Okay, and most warmly, of course, I'd like to welcome you, our BA and MA freshers. Notice that I use this term freshers rather than freshmen. We know some of BA, some of our MA freshers because they are our alumni of our BA program. They have decided to stay on and write their MA thesis in American Studies. Welcome to this event, and I should say thank you for entrusting your education and your early career to us. A few words about the American Studies Center would be in order. We are one of the largest American Studies departments in Europe. We teach US American Studies to our BAs and more widely understood American Studies to our MAs, incorporating a kind of a wider Western hemispheric perspective. Our program is to a great extent multidisciplinary, combining political science, history, economics, culture, religion, and culture and religion studies, art history, and literature. As I said, the ASC faculty consists of 30 permanent members from Poland, United States, and Mexico. We're joined by as many as 30 faculty, adjunct and visiting faculty. We offer good research. We think we offer good research facilities for our students, American Studies scholars, and professionals interested in the field. We associate, as the ASC faculty, we associate with and invite scholars with extensive North American, US and Mexican, Cuban experience or Western hemispheric experience. We have a large American Studies library. All our instruction is in English, and we have some Spanish courses as well. We are an English language department, a rather unique thing at the University of Warsaw, with some Spanish language courses as well, especially at the MA level. We promote American Studies in Poland. We host conferences. We will host, hopefully, if things go well, we will host the European Association for American Studies in the spring, next May, something that was planned for this May and was called off for obvious reasons. We are home of research groups and students, reading groups. I hope you will want to work in both. We publish two peer-reviewed journals. I don't know if it matters at this point that much, but we're on two floors at Ksawerów, and if these were normal times, we would be working on two floors at Ksawerów, at the Ksawerów building at Niepodległości 22, the first floor and the third one, as many of you know. The second one is in between, is occupied by the University of Warsaw Center for Europe. So as you know, most of our instruction will be online. We do have some special solutions, in-person solutions for BA freshers in particular. I understand many of you here, since you could come over here for this event, you're also the ones who have signed up for the American History and Society in-person classes that will in fact be held in person at the Ksawerów building. So, and yet I would encourage all of you, including those of you who are now watching us on our website, to seek some in-person contact with the faculty. You can always make an appointment, and our faculty, most of our faculty, will be able to see you in person, but in a kind of a face-to-face or mask-to-mask meeting. Now, BA freshers here, you will see us move, and you will be part of that movement. You will see us move in 2022-23 to a new building at Dobra 55, only a 5-minute walk downhill from here across the street from the main library, as you know, this building that is now currently under construction. I also suggest that you regularly check our website. We spend a lot of time updating our website, so the most updated info about our programs, about our operations, can be found on our website in the news and events section. As I said, Filip Boratin, who is here with us, he is a member of the ASC staff, but also a very talented young scholar. I know he's planning a kind of pre-recorded manual on how to navigate our website and the USOS system. We are on popularly used social media. We have two Facebook profiles where we will be posting all our events. We have a YouTube channel, of course. We're on Twitter and Instagram, okay? I feel we should move on with our formal part, and I'll let other members of the faculty here speak. I'll introduce you to Professor Tomasz Basiuk. I should explain that the American Studies Center is part of a larger department. It's called the Institute of the Americas in Europe. That department is on a par with the large University of Warsaw departments, like, you know, Department of Management or Physics. So Professor Basiuk, apart from being an important ASC faculty member, he's also our dean. He will want to say hello to you. Professor Basiuk.
Thank you very much. Welcome. I only have a few words to say, and I'll be very brief. First of all, in case you haven't gotten the point of what Professor Kosh has just said, I work for him, he works for me. Okay, that's how it works. And this is how it should be. And my point is that this kind of, I think, illustrates something very important about learning. Okay, well, you have come here in order to learn from us. We are the faculty, you're the students. But that's just one side of the coin. That is just a part of the story. We live in a time of change, as I think everyone is very well aware. The pandemic, the situation that we are in, the partial lockdowns and so on, they are something that is very crucially important to us today. I think this will pass soon, but there are other changes which may not just go away. For example, you know, are we still in a kind of global situation, or are we in a situation that will become dominated by populism or isolationism of some kind? I don't think that we have an answer to a question like that today. There's a number of answers that seem possible. Normally, I think when people come to the university to study, they expect that this will advance their job prospects. They think of a career and so on. And of course, that makes perfect sense. It is reasonable, and you should be thinking it that way too. At the same time, think about an industry, a very vibrant industry, like tourism, right? I mean, is tourism still with us? Will it be there in a year or two? I mean, we don't know. There are so many things we don't know at this point. And I just want to say that when you come to the American Studies Center, you need to move beyond thinking of yourself as a kind of, you know, kernel sitting in a silo called American Studies, waiting to be cultivated so we can germinate and then, you know, kind of spread out and have a wonderful life and career as an Americanist. This hopefully may come to pass for you, but it may also turn out differently given the various weird, unusual, unexpected circumstances that I've been touching on just a minute ago. You need to think for yourselves about what it is that you're here for. You're here because you've either scored very, very well in your high school graduation exams, or because you've done very well on our very challenging entrance exam for the master's program. But that is now behind you. That doesn't matter anymore. You need to think about what happens next. And what happens next is that you are responsible for your own learning. You, of course, need to attend classes, you need to take courses, you need to pass those courses, and so on and so forth. But that is just a small part of what you're doing here, okay? The university is not built of silos. The university is more like a maze or a fun house or like a labyrinth, and you need to find your way through it on your own. You need to figure out what interests you. You need to figure out which other classes to take across the university in other departments. You need to find out which books to read. You need to find out which reading groups or student clubs interest you and join them and do something about what's going on there. Take part. However, don't think of yourself as just being a single individual moving through that maze. You are a group of people. You're a cohort. You're there with friends or people who will become your friends. Make sure that you work with them. Just like Greg and I, you know, we exist in this kind of weird, double-sided, hierarchical relationship, but that's just a part of what we are, okay? You need to also think of yourselves as being together as a group, and you need to show some solidarity, or you need to show some kind of relationality to those other people. That may mean, in a very simple way, just turning on your camera when you're in a Zoom meeting with your class so that people can see what you look like and so you can smile at others and so on. Just a small beginning. But moving beyond that, you need to figure out, and this is a real challenge given that you will not be meeting in real time in physical space most of this semester at least, if not for a longer time. You need to figure out how to make those connections. And I hope that you can do that. And I hope that you can see and understand that this is a part of what your learning experience will be. Good luck with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bashuk. Thank you, Tomek. Okay, I'll now invite to the rostrum Professor Kuzma, Sylwia Kuzma-Markowska. Let me explain to you what her administrative role is. She's the head of the Teaching and Learning Council at the Institute of the Americas and Europe, okay, which is a kind of a larger body overseeing all programs and all teaching and learning within this larger department, not just the ASC, but the Institute of the Americas and Europe. She wants to greet you. It's important that you can recognize her as a very important official organizing your programs. Professor Kuzma-Markowska, please.
So thank you for this introduction. So I would like just simply and briefly welcome you here at the American Studies Center and join Professor Bashuk in trying to incite you, to encourage you to get involved into as many student related activities as possible. So please consider becoming a member of the Student Union. I think it is very important to have an impact on what is decided here at the American Studies Center regarding students' matters, and you can be like a very active part in all of this. So it's great to see you. I hope that we are meeting, well, we are meeting in extraordinary circumstances, but I hope that soon we will be able to meet in person, in classes, and in other situations. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you. Okay, now it's time for another performance. We'll have the choir sing Gaudi Mater Polonia, the oldest Polish anthem or hymn, whose history goes back to the 13th century. I think we should stand up again. Thank you. Be seated. It's too beautiful, isn't it? Okay. Now, to kick off this academic year, we've planned a special treat for you today. This will be a lecture by Professor Pawel Frelik, and I will invite him in a minute to this rostrum. Professor Frelik is a permanent faculty member of the ASC. He teaches science fiction, he teaches audiovisual media, he teaches about film, television, video games, music videos, and popular culture. He's a very, very popular, great, great teacher. He offers a number of courses that are almost impossible to get into, you'll find. He has published widely. He has an international reputation. He has published widely. Most recently, he's published a book, Kultury Wizualne Science Fiction by Universitas. Professor Pawel Frelik has served on the boards of several prestigious journals, science fiction studies, Extrapolation, Journal of Gaming and Virtual World. He is the co-editor of a science fiction book series, New Dimensions in Science Fiction, at the University of Wales Press. He is a widely known scholar with lots of connections. He has been a Fulbright visiting scholar at University of California, Riverside. He has been a recipient of several prestigious awards, and Opus research grants from the National Science Center Poland. I can't emphasize enough that all of this makes him a very special speaker today at this ASC welcome event. Please join me in welcoming Professor Pawel Frelik.
Thank you, Greg. this is quite an introduction to live up to, but I'll try. So, hello everyone, especially people who are not here with us physically. And I would like to begin with a short clip, the opening credits for a television series. So, a good chance is that you have never heard about Motherland, Fort Salem. Its first season, comprising 10 episodes, premiered on March 18th this year, which is barely a week into the beginning of a pandemic, and somehow flew under most people's radar. I watch more television than is good for me, and I only came upon it by accident. Unless you watch niche television and film, you will not recognize any cast faces, except perhaps for Taylor Hickson, who had a very small role in Deadpool. Finally, I don't think you will know Freeform, the producing cable channel that technically belongs to Disney, which is not even available officially in Europe, unless you know how to use a VPN or procure television from other sources. So in short, Motherland, Fort Salem is pretty obscure. You might wonder why I decided to show it to you, and not such much loved classics of American visual culture as Transformers, this is irony, or Friends, this is also irony, although I know I'm breaking some hearts here. I chose Motherland, Fort Salem precisely because of its obscurity, but also because it reflects and encapsulates many complexities and contradictions of the United States and its culture. But let me begin with a very short plot summary. Motherland, Fort Salem is an alternate history, a subgenre often considered part of science fiction or fantasy. It is set in the contemporary United States, but it is a country in which women have played central roles since the early colonies ended persecution of witches in the late 17th century during the Salem witch trials, following an agreement known as the Salem Accord of 1692. Since then, witches, many of whom live in the territory known as the Session, as you can see right here, joined the US Army, fighting American wars, both international and domestic, against a terrorist organization known as the Spree, a group that opposes a semi-compulsory conscription of witches into the armed forces. The series itself revolves around three characters, Ra'el Collar, Abigail Bellwether, and Tally Craven, three young adepts who have just joined the Cadet Academy. They train in combat magic and use their vocal cords to enact so-called seeds or seed sounds, layering vocal sounds to create powerful spells. There are, of course, as they need to be, romance subplots, but it's their witchhood and service that remain at the core of the series. You still with me? I know, this really seems like a ridiculous plot. I mean, the United States Witch Corps? I mean, what's next, Harry Potter? But of course, media in general, and television in particular, no matter how popular or obscure, centrally shape our audience's mindsets and worldviews. When you look closer at Motherland's Fort Salem, you will notice that it is a surprisingly progressive series, both in itself and against the standards of American television, which by and large is fairly conservative. The plot summary makes it clear that women occupy center stage in this story world. This centrality is already visible in the opening credits, which you have just seen, and their adaptation of one of the most iconic American paintings, depicting the first move against the British Army in 1776 during the American Revolutionary War. And the painting, of course, is Emmanuel Leutze's Washington Crossing the Delaware, which you can see down here, which replaces the first president and his entourage with the witch leader and her companions. The Witch Cadet Academy is racially and ethnically diverse, and one of the oldest lines of witches is that of the Bellwethers, an African-American family that is the military royalty in the series world. The series also features a same-sex romance between major characters, Ra'el and Scylla Ramshorn. Finally, it demonstrates an awareness of places and conflicts outside of the United States, including the ethnic purges of minorities in Asia. Now, all fantastic narratives, regardless of whether we call them science fiction, fantasy, or supernatural, like here, are most productively understood as metaphors and allegories, always of the now and the here. Consequently, these plot elements that I have just very briefly described position themselves vis-a-vis American life and its gender, racial, and political legacies. By their matter-of-fact presence in the series, they make more visible the absence of such equalities from other series, but also from real life. Spells and magic are, needless to say, fictional, but the recognition of gender, racial, and sexual rights is a real political issue. So far, so good then. But when you look even closer, though, and we will teach you how to look really closely, but about this in a few minutes, the seemingly optimistic panorama darkens. The progressive elements are still there, but the bigger picture is no longer so rosy. As we move deeper into the series, it's 10 episodes only, it becomes clear that the witch core is often used to favor American interests beyond anti-terrorism and national security, or rather, that the definition of that security is treated very flexibly. In fact, more often than not, the commander, General Sarah Alder, comes across as a war hawk who will break international laws to protect what she sees as her nation's security. It does not take a history degree to know that, especially after 1945, the same excuse has often been used to justify military adventurism and protect the country's economic prosperity, not infrequently at the expense of other territories and nations. And speaking of Alder, she was the original witch who struck a deal with the Puritans in Salem and signed the Salem Accords back in 1692. And yet, For the first three episodes of the season, we see her as a beautiful woman of 40. Witches will be witches, the old saying goes. Well, not really. But curiously, older is almost always accompanied by a circle of old women who never say anything, except for disapprovingly tutting when someone disrespects or disobeys their general. The role is revealed in episode 4, when one of the elders, and these are dark slides, but I'll just describe to you what is happening in them. The role is revealed in episode 4, when one of the elders dies and needs to be replaced by a young cadet who volunteers to keep the beloved general alive and whose youth is siphoned off within minutes, turning her into an old woman while preserving the beauty of a commander. This, of course, makes for a very imaginative instance of what cultural theory calls ageism, a societal prejudice that worships female youthfulness and erases older women. Incidentally, it is often reported that in the film and television industries, the age over which women dramatically drop out of casting and visibility, except for the biggest stars, is around 40. Exactly the same age at which General Alder is forever arrested in her stern beauty. Last but not least, Motherland Fort Salem is very classist. As I mentioned, the series is very egalitarian when it comes to gender, race, and sexuality, but it still uncritically presents the family lines of the first generations of witches as deserving of privilege. It is nice to see the bellwethers, women of color, in positions of power, but it is also difficult not to think of aristocracy and privilege of birth that often comes up even in the discussions among the youngest cadets at the school. This again resonates with the biggest blind spot in the majority of public discussions in the United States. We can talk about race, ethnicity, sexuality, ableism, and probably several other categories of identity difference, as long as we don't dwell too much on economic class, which is, of course, very often connected to birth. Like one of the awesome characters in Scott Pilgrim versus the World, which you should totally see if you haven't already, you could ask, great story, man, so what? So Motherland Fort Salem is a miniature of the United States. It is a series that begins its narrative arc in the first century of a European settlement of North America and ties its origin story to the event, the Salem witch trials, that so early demonstrates the abyss between the utopian dream and the dystopian practice. So, for the next 2, 3, or 5 years, depending on which of our programs you are now entering and on how long you intend to stay with us, we are going to show you the unresolvable contradictions and furious complexities that underpin and define American history, literature, culture, media, politics, economy, and social life. We are going to teach you about the painful contrast between the idealistic desire to start anew in a place that was, when that desire formed, at the end of the world, and the genocide of a native population that paved the way, literally and metaphorically, for that dream. Between Wyoming's granting women their voting rights as early as 1869 and the continued struggle for their full equality still in the 21st century. Between the fact that in 2020, more white Americans stood together with the Black Lives Matter protesters than ever before, and the shameful stigma of a KKK's burning crosses. Between the 2015 Supreme Court decision on same-sex marriage and the decades of criminalizing of sexual difference. Between the obscene wealth of a Silicon Valley's digital barons and the fact that many full-time Walmart employees permanently live below the poverty line. And finally, between a country as Steve Erickson, the writer Steve Erickson, wrote in his spellbinding novel, These Dreams of You, this is a quote, a country capable of imagining what cannot be imagined, and then, once it's imagined, doing it. And a country, as Will McAvoy says in the very first episode of the HBO drama Newsroom, the country that leads the world, again, this is a quote from this television series, the country that leads the world in only three categories: number of incarcerated citizens per capita, number of adults who believe angels are real, and the defense spending, where we spend more than the next 26 countries combined, 25 of whom are allies. The end of the quote. The United States is these contradictions and many, many more. You will likely find that most things that you think you know about the United States are wrong or incomplete. But if it's okay, the only way to seek knowledge is to open your hands and let your opinions drop to the floor. Leave them down there, you'll have new ones. And let me tell you something else. These discoveries and realizations and epiphanies will not end with the United States. Of course, at the American Studies Center, we primarily focus on the United States, with a healthy sprinkling of knowledge about other American countries, although I do have to admit we are very thin on Canada. Sorry. But many types of knowledge, insights, and reflections will not stay inside the US borders. They will help you understand not only the Americas, but also the world and yourselves. Many of these discoveries will be difficult, since they will push you out of your comfort zone. They will force you to reassess what you have believed to be true for so long. The United States is furiously complex and messy, and so is the world. We will not give you easy knowledge. We will give you the capacity to think critically and ask difficult questions with no clean answers. This is what the university does. This is what I would like to think we do at the American Studies Center. So welcome, freshers. We hope you like it here with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Pavel. Thank you, Professor Frelik.
Now let's have the virtual choir sing for us again. That'll be Gaudeamus Igitur. Can you please stand up again? Thank you. Okay, we have three more people to meet, and I'll invite to this rostrum Dr. Małgorzata Gajda-Łaszewska. She is the ASC Counselor for Students Affairs. She will be the official to talk to if you want to leave or if you want to negotiate your exam schedule. She's also a very good person to talk to if you have a problem. Okay, one question.
Oh yes. So now, when you have seen all the stars and you have the peek at this academic adventures and intellectual voyages, I'm here to say that on a daily basis, you're also in good hands. So now it's time for service and maintenance, and that's me. So I'm the counselor for Students Affairs, so my task is to help you get where and when you want to get as smoothly and safely as possible. And many of you will not get to know me at all during your studies, and this is my deepest wish for you, because it means that everything goes fine and you know, according to schedule, and nicely and smoothly. But generally, together with the ASC office, which was actually declared one of the most friendly office, students' offices at the University of Warsaw, which is a great privilege and honor to be a part of it. We are going to take care of you. We are going to take care of you of all your needs, but also to execute your duties. So whatever needs to be done has to be done, and we are going to help you. And together with Filip Boratin, who is a representative of the office today with us, we are going to assist you on a daily basis. So as a result, on the one hand, we would be probably the most nagging and niggling persons at the center, but on the other hand, ultimately we are the one who deliver when something bad happens. We value individualism very high, but as you know, we are the team people, so if anything gets wrong, let us know. We are here for you, and in face of any problems, technical help or health or any other, we are the first to know. Or if you want to change something, to improve something, also let us know. You have to be confident that the choice that you have made is a good one, that coming here was a good move, as I believe it was. So make it your place and care for it as we care for it. And so welcome aboard and have a good year, online or in person, hopefully in person in spring. Let's go it together. That's it.
Thank you, Małgosia. Thank you, Dr. Gajda Waszewska. That was kierownik do spraw toku studiów, right? The counselor for students affairs. Another person you should be aware of, who unfortunately can't be here with us because she's on sick leave and it's not COVID as far as I know. She couldn't join us here today, Dr. Marta Usiekniewicz. She is the BA Fresher Coordinator, opiekun pierwszego roku studiów licencjackich, BA Fresher Coordinator. So, as I said, she cannot be here with us today, yet we will, what we will be dealing with is her virtual presence. She's sent in a recording introducing you to some of the basic things she thinks you should know, and also introducing herself. So if we can turn to that recording now.
Hi everyone, my name is Marta Usiekniewicz and I am BA Freshers Counselor. So for all of you starting your journey with the ASC, I'm your point of contact with issues you might have. I'm sure that during this welcome event, you've already heard and met some of the people who are there to assist you in your transition into our community, but just know that I'm here. And part of what I'm doing is to provide you with resources and information about making your life that much easier in your first year at the ASC. I am so sorry not to be there with you, but I hope that this is a nice introduction to the almost all online semester. So I hope that even though most of your communication with your peers and your instructors will be online, I hope that you will still get to enjoy this first semester. I wanted to spend my short time talking about three things that might make your life easier. First thing that I want to share with you, and please bear with me as I share a presentation with you. hopefully you can see it, is I want, as a OZN coordinator, I want to make you aware of this component of your program at the ASC. This is basically meant to make your 3 years at OSA a more rounded experience. You are encouraged to look for lectures, events, and other conferences that are outside of OSA or organized at OSA that are outside of the classes that you are taking. And throughout the year, throughout the 3 years at OSA, you are supposed to collect a set number of OZN points. Now, it is important that in order to do that, you are aware of the places where we announce events that count as OZN. So I hope that all of you have your smartphones with you. So this is a time where you can Google on Facebook OZN OSA profile, as well as the ASC virtual lecture hall. These are two spaces where we announce OZN events, both online and in real life. I also encourage all of you to submit your own suggestions of OZN events, such as if you're sitting in a different faculty, maybe they're organizing something, you're part of a group that does something academic, artistic, political, these might be good ideas for OZNs. And please know that apart from just collecting points, you can get your OZN grade when you participate in academic conferences, take part in internships, and some forms of activism. So please bear that in mind. Here is how the OZN OSA Facebook profile works. If you're not on Facebook because you think it's for old people, set up an account anyway, just to follow some of the ASC social media. You will also find all of the information about OZN collection, both online and in real life, at the ASC website. I would also like you to make sure that you tab this very useful resource. And finally, please also add yourself to the open public group on Facebook called ASC Virtual Lecture Hall, where we post information specifically about ASC online events, ones that we organize for you. And coming to my second point, events organized by OSA for you. Within this month and the beginning of the next month, I am going to organize a three-part seminar series online for you, first-year students, to help you on your smooth transition, either from high school to university life or from a different faculty to our faculty. This is entitled How to Survive at ASC, Useful Tips, Skills, and Know-How for Academia. And these are three seminars. You get 2 points for each, so you can understand the math there. So the things that we will cover this week, Philippe Baratin, that I'm sure either was introduced to you or will be introduced to you today, is going to talk about ASC administration and online spaces, and this is definitely something you should pay great attention to. Navigating USAS, navigating our online resources, is very important for your smooth sailing in the upcoming 3 years. Now, after a short break on Thursday, October 29th, at 4:45, another member of our faculty, Anna Kurowicka, is going to give you a workshop on soft skills. This is especially important now when so much of our teaching and interaction is online, talking about etiquette during online classes, communication with your instructors and peers, as well as inclusive language and some of the differences between being a student at school and being a student at a university. And finally, part three, this is where Ludmila Janion on November 5th, also at 4:45, will talk about kind of practical tips and skills and useful ways of preparing yourselves for classes and kind of how to benefit most from the online instruction and real life instruction that we offer on OSA. All of these events are going to be online, and we will be posting links for each event on Facebook, on our website, and other other social media channels. So please, please take part in that. It's very important that you pay attention to your UW email. All the emails that you're getting are sent to you for a reason. I also would like to encourage you to follow other ASC channels of communications. We have a Facebook, a Twitter, and Instagram, and I'm sure also that the Student Union will tell you all about the ways in which you can engage with them. Finally, I just wanted to talk you through some other opportunities outside of OZATENS and outside of the classes that you're taking. Not just a teaching institution, we are a research institution. There are quite a lot of research groups at OSA, and you can find an overview of them on our website. And so one that I would especially invite you to is a Weird Fictions research group, which is very much open to students. It's run by Agnieszka Kotwa-Sińska, but you can also find many, many other groups of interest to do with science fiction, gender, leadership. So make sure you benefit from that as well and get to know more students and other faculty that you might not be introduced to during your regular classes. Thank you so much for taking the time to hear me. I cannot wait to see you all either in person or online, and I hope you have a great event. Bye.
So we have one more speaker, so bear with me, sort of to recapitulate so far what we've done. You've met the dean of the American Study of the Institute of the Americas and Institute of the Americas in Europe, the head of the Teaching and Learning Council at the IAEA, a talk by Professor Pawel Frelik about a TV series that no one has seen yet. Kierownik do spraw toku studiów, dr Gajda Łaszewska. You've met opiekun pierwszego roku studiów licencjackich, dr Marta Usiekniewicz. And we have one more speaker, that is the head of the Student Union, Aleksandra Mackiewicz.
Hello, everyone. On behalf of the ASC Students Union, it is my pleasure to welcome you at the American Study Center Welcome Event. Currently, I am the president of the Students Union, and I want you to know that in case you have any problems, questions, or doubts, I am here for you, and we can figure everything out together. I have a message to the BA and MA freshers. I hope that you will spend here a wonderful time full of great memories, lifetime friendships, and extensive knowledge about the United States of America. And if there are any older students watching and listening, I hope that you are not tired of the remote classes and that you will make it to the next semester. Also, this semester is going to be rather calm in terms of events since pandemic is still here. Nevertheless, hopefully in spring we'll have plenty, many opportunities to meet and to organize events connected with the American culture. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Ola. Thank you for joining us for this. My hope is this semester will be truly satisfying for you. Much of it will be remote, I'm afraid, for obvious reasons. We have acquired some experience in remote teaching, and we are going to do our best to help you grow intellectually and to develop your skills. Thank you very much. Thanks. That's it.